Friends, we arise and join in confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Thanks be to you, Lord Christ, most merciful Redeemer, for the countless blessings and benefits you give. May we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly day by day, praising you with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from 1 Corinthians. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are beneficial. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. Food is meant for the stomach, and the stomach for food, and God will destroy both one and the other. The body is meant not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord and will also raise us by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Should I therefore take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that whoever is united to a prostitute becomes one body with her? For it is said, the two shall be one flesh. But anyone united to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Shun fornication. Every sin that a person commits is outside the body, but the fornicator sins against the body itself. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia.
Lord, to whom shall we go?
You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia.
According to John, in the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses and the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked Jesus, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And Jesus said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Lord, we pray that you will help open our eyes and our hearts and our spirits to the fullness of your gift in our lives and of your promise. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, I got a an impersonation for you. And just so that you know, only old people are going to get it. All right. "You must remember this. A kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is still a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by." Who is it?
Jimmy Durante.
Woo! And here I thought I was doing Bing Crosby. Jimmy Durante, the old schnozzola. Ha-cha-cha-cha-cha. And if he didn't say this, I'm putting it in his mouth anyway. You ain't seen nothing yet, Tom.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because that is the theme. I have to say, I don't know if Teddy Roosevelt ever knew he was going to be followed by Jimmy Durante up here in the pulpit. The theme of this calling of the disciples in John, it is still about the revelation of Jesus, the Epiphany, the revealing of Jesus. And it is about this beautiful promise that you ain't seen nothing yet. You will see so much more to come. Now, the gospel lesson takes place shortly after Jesus has been baptized by John in the Jordan River. So he's still down at the Jordan River in the area of the baptizing. And the day before, John the Baptist, when Jesus was walking by, said, "There goes the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world." And Andrew, Peter's brother Andrew, and another disciple, unnamed, are interested in what John said. So they go follow Jesus and visit with him that day after his invitation, "Come and see." And seeing what they could see in the course of that evening with Jesus, they were very excited. Andrew went and told his brother Peter, who was also somewhere abouts, and introduced Jesus to him and said, "Here's the guy. Here's the guy." So the next morning, Philip, who must have been with them that evening, Philip comes to find another friend, Nathanael. Nathanael is sitting under a fig tree. And just so you know, that doesn't mean Nathanael is lazing about. Fig tree was a nice shade tree, but a fig tree in Scripture and sitting under a fig tree is an allusion to studying the faith. This was where the rabbis would gather, and they would sit under the fig tree with a group of people that might want to come and discuss, and they would discuss the faith. So it's a picture that Nathanael is someone that cares about the faith, someone that looks into the faith, that wants to see more. The invitation, "You ain't seen nothing yet." So Philip comes to him, and he says to Nathanael, "We found the one that Moses and the prophets speak about," meaning the Messiah. "We have found him, and he is Jesus, son of Joseph, from Nazareth." And that would be the normal way to introduce Jesus to somebody. Jesus, son of Joseph, where? From Nazareth. And Nathanael immediately says, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Now, it sounds kind of disrespectful. But remember, he is a student of the Scripture. And Nazareth is not mentioned once in the Old Testament. Nazareth is a village that is tucked between three hills, kind of if we could imagine our balcony, you know, kind of three hills, and we're in the little valley in between. And there's one road in, and the same road takes you out again. If you want to go over those hills to some other village, you're going to take the donkey path or a walking path or something. And it only has one spring, which means the water source for Nazareth was very limited. And if the water is going to be limited, what else is going to be limited? Population is going to be limited. And so biblical archaeologists, those kinds of folks, have decided that probably there were 480, was a number I saw, people at the very most that lived in Nazareth. To give perspective, that is about the same if we add up the residents on the Lutheran campus. If we take the long-term care and the assisted living, and we take the folks in the duplexes and the various apartments, That's about the village of Nazareth. In other words, it's podunk. It's nowhere. Now, it's a pretty nice little tucked away safe place for the Messiah to grow up, I think. And maybe that's why he was from Nazareth. Nobody would pay any attention to you there. And Nathanael, being a good student of the scripture, he just says it like it is. He's not trying to put down Nazareth, although there may have been some, rivalry. Cana was a bigger, not a huge, but a bigger village. And the roads went through Cana as people traveled hither and yon. And Nathanael was from Cana, somewhere on the other side of those hills. Imagine it'd be a little bit like a high school rivalry between Faulkner and Frewsburg, or whichever the big rivalries are. And he says, what good can come out of, what significance can come out of that place? It's not in Scripture. At least Bethlehem is in Scripture. Nazareth? Forget about it. But when Philip says, come and see, what does Nathanael do? He comes and sees. He says, all right, well, I'll see. I don't know what good it'll do, what good comes out of Nazareth. I'm just going to tell you up front, but I'll come. And as he comes, then Jesus, speaking to people that are around him, says, a true Israelite, a true Israelite, one that cares about the faith and understanding the faith and moving deeper into the faith and living that faith, a true Israelite in whom there is no guile, there is no deceit, there is no falsehood. In other words, the truth as he knows it is what he tells. Now, sometimes we don't want a person to tell us the truth as they know it, as we want to live with a little bit of fantasy, perhaps, about ourselves or our lives. So he could be annoying, but he will only tell the truth, and when he says something to you, you know that at least he believes it. And so, when Jesus says, here's this Israelite in whom there is no guile, Nathanael hears him, and Nathanael says, how did you get to know me? Where did you learn about me? How did you know that I am a true Israelite and I have no guile? Now that sounds a little bit arrogant. I am a true Israelite and I have no guile. But remember, he has no guile, so he just speaks the truth as he knows it. And Jesus says to him, I saw you under that fig tree. I saw you and your study. And I am now here to bring you so much further. You ain't seen nothing yet. And simply because he says, I saw you under the fig tree, and this little miracle, I suppose, of Jesus knowing him without having met him, Nathanael, suddenly he tells a new truth as he knows it. A truth far from can anything good come out of Nazareth. He says, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Philip told him, we found this fellow, Jesus. But now Nathanael proclaims him, Rabbi, son of Joseph. And Nathanael proclaims, son of God from Nazareth. And Nathanael proclaims, King of Israel. And yet for all that proclamation and all that understanding, do they yet even begin to know the fullness of the glory of God in Jesus Christ? No. And Jesus invites them. He invites us. Always look further, look deeper. and look to the cross. Look to the cross. You ain't seen nothing yet. But you will see, he tells them. You will see. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We see the glory of God in that liturgical phrase. And even we who know the death and resurrection of Jesus, there is still for us what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, what no human mind has conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. Christ will come again. We ain't seen none yet. Amen.
Sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright.
rise and with the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For the body of Christ gathered throughout the world, and for all servants of the gospel, that following Jesus, the church lives out its calling every day, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the well-being of creation, for plants and animals, and for all that God has marvelously made, that we serve as wide stewards of earth, our home, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For police officers and firefighters, for attorneys and paralegals, for peacekeepers and military personnel, and for the leaders of governments, that they provide protection to all people, especially the most vulnerable, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For those lacking food or shelter, for those who are sick or grieving, and for those who are imprisoned or homebound, that God console all who suffer, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For our neighborhood, for visitors joining us for the first time or returning, and for those absent from our assembly, that all who seek to know God are nourished by word and sacrament, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Tend to all in need of your compassion. Hear the cries of those awaiting justice and those yearning for forgiveness. Give community to the lonely and neighbors to the outcast. Shelter all who are vulnerable in body, mind, or spirit. We pray this day for Tom, Joe, Robert, Deborah, Jerry, Lucy, Marge, Cecilia, Sharon, Annie, the family of Carol Ann Lynn, and those we name aloud or in our hearts before you.
Family of Larry Ross.
Our nation.
Mark. Cart. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
In thanksgiving for the saints who have gone before us, that their lives give us a vision of the gospel in action, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace forever. The Lord be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace forever. Amen. Amen.
Go in peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.